Good afternoon. Can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? I ask members to take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat or when moving about the Chamber. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is COVID-19 recovery and parliamentary business. If members wish to ask a supplementary question, they would need to press the request to speak button or press the R in the chat function if they're joining us online, and to do so at the time of the relevant question. I call question number one, which is from Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its policies and actions across government are supporting communities to recover from COVID-19.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, recovery from the pandemic is an urgent priority for the Government. The policies we set out in May and delivered within 100 days were bold, ambitious and transformative measures. I want to assure Mr Fairley that this is only the beginning of the Government's programme, and there's much more that we can and will do to build a fairer and more sustainable country as we continue to drive Scotland's recovery from the pandemic. These 80 commitments, all delivered, were coordinated and targeted policies for demonstrable positive change for the people, families and communities who need it most, and for our economy, public services and environment.
Mr Fairley.
I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. In my own constituency, the North Perth and City Centre COVID-19 Community Support Group was formed during the pandemic. It's an affiliation of community groups across the area like Letham for All, North Mutant Community Council, Tullochnet and many, many others. They mobilised over 180 volunteers to help with everything from food shopping to delivering prescriptions and to quite simply being someone to talk to. Does the Scottish Government have any plans to be able to sustain and utilise the skills and resource that these community groups offer?
Cabinet Secretary.
I want to echo the comments that Mr Fairley has made. I'm familiar with a number of the organisations to which he referred, not least of which North Muirton Community Council in my own constituency. And these organisations have provided absolutely critical services to members of the public in the City of Perth, as I know similar organisations have done in other parts of the country. With our work with local government, we want to focus on a community-based approach to COVID recovery and to sustain many of the examples of good community initiatives that have come forward during the pandemic, which can act to support individuals, particularly with vulnerability or loneliness, within our communities. That was what we envisaged when we brought forward the Community Empowerment Act to enable much greater community participation and engagement, and that will be central to the response that the Government takes forward in relation to supporting organisations to make that meaningful impact on their communities.
Got a number of supplementaries. Firstly, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In communities across Scotland, there are many individuals who are still waiting to make an appointment for a face-to-face meeting with their GP. I know this is an issue that is addressed by the Scottish Government in their plan for NHS recovery, but can the Cabinet Secretary update us on what the target date might be when we get back to some degree of normality for those wanting to meet their GP face-to-face?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think one of the important points to note here is that the process of meeting the needs of individuals during the pandemic has required many public servants, including general practitioners, to work in different ways, and they have all risen to that challenge. Some of these models of operation are models of operation that we don't want to lose once the pandemic is over. So accessing public services through video consultations, which many GPs have taken forward, is, I think, a beneficial way to ensure that the maximum number of people can get the treatment when they require. There is, of course, a very, very significant role for face-to-face consultations to be undertaken. And general practitioners around the country are working very hard, and it's envisaged within the NHS recovery plan, to maximise the degree of face-to-face consultation that's possible to be undertaken. But I wouldn't want that to be seen at the expense of us continuing to use different technology advances which have enabled us to deliver healthcare services and other services during the pandemic.
Thank you. Jackie Bailey.
The Cabinet Secretary will recognise that carers are a key section of our community. They are struggling and many of them are still isolating as case numbers rise to record levels. For some, their care packages were withdrawn at the start of the pandemic, respite care was stopped and carers were left to cope alone. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell me when all these services will be restored and where is the remobilisation plan for social care?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, these issues are covered in the NHS recovery plan and in the wider steps that we are taking to recover public services, which are in many respects taken forward by our local authority partners. And what partners are doing is trying to re-establish services as safely and as sustainably as possible. But Jackie Bailey, in a sense, answers part of her own question in her own words, with the challenges of rising case numbers and the anxiety that will cause to individuals who may have some health vulnerabilities as a consequence. So we are working very closely and in partnership with a variety of different organisations to make sure that we restore services to meet the needs of individuals, but it has to be commensurate with that being safe to do so in the context of the pandemic. And of course, the First Minister will have more to say on that when she addresses Parliament this afternoon.
And briefly, Alex Rowley.
Presiding Officer, thank you. The issue in terms of care in the community is a major issue. I don't know how the government starts to prioritise, but in Fife, for example, the numbers of people on waiting lists to get a care package has spiralled out of control. Will the government look specifically at how they can intervene? Because the Health and Social Care Partnership are saying they simply cannot recruit the carers in order to provide the care. And this is stocking up a major problem as we move into the winter.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Mr Rowley puts his finger on a very significant issue, which is the availability of personnel to undertake some tasks, essential tasks in our society. And I think we are all hearing across a range of different sectors. Mr Rowley has understandably highlighted the social care sector, but we're hearing it in a number of sectors where there are quite simply not enough people to come forward for recruitment in certain occupations. That's a consequence of the reduction in the number of people available because of the removal of free movement of individuals as a consequence of Brexit. It is undoubtedly having an effect on the number of people available. We are working with health and social care partnerships to maximise the opportunities for recruitment, and we'll continue to discuss these issues with local authorities and with health boards as we support the recovery of these services, which is essential, is undertaken to meet the needs of individuals in our society.
Thank you. Question number two, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how its policies and actions across government will support Inverclyde to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has provided Inverclyde Council with £7,651,250 to support businesses in the area during the COVID-19 pandemic. As part of the economic stimulus package in 2020-21, we provided an additional £100,000 to Inverclyde Council from the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund to ensure the delivery of the new Craig End Resource Centre in Greenock. Inverclyde Council has also been awarded up to £504,804 worth of funding from the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund in 21-22 to support the delivery of services for the Inverclyde Shed Meet, Make and Share project, also in Greenock. Scottish Enterprise are also working with the area to deliver regional business support plans and to support regional company growth pilots.
Supplementary, Stuart McMillan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer, and he is very much aware of some of the challenges Inverclyde faces, even pre the pandemic. It's in the recent SDS report, Regional Skills Assessments for West Region, published in July 2021, it states Inverclyde is not expected to meet pre-pandemic employment levels in the period up to 2031. My area does need additional assistance to arrest a population decline and also to deal with our ageing population demographic. In light of this, I ask if there is anything further that the Scottish Government would consider doing to support Inverclyde to recover from the pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Government is very open to further discussions with the local community and with the local authority on what steps can be taken. There is a great deal of planning has already been undertaken through the work of the Glasgow City Region, which is essentially taking forward a range of different projects that will involve an impact on Inverclyde. and the government will be open to further dialogue beyond the propositions that are advanced in that proposal. The Glasgow City Region deal supports three projects in Inverclyde, and these will promote growth in the area. And the issue that Mr McMillan raises of population decline is one of the central issues in that, in the focus of that work, and the government stands ready to support Inverclyde Council and local partners in the most effective way we can to advance some of these priorities that will assist in addressing population decline.
Thank you. Question number three, Co-Cabinet.
I'd like to ask the Scottish Government how its policies and actions across government will support local authorities in their recovery from COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, to date, we have provided Scottish local authorities with an additional £1.5 billion in direct support through the Local Government Finance Settlement, over and above the regular grant payments for COVID recovery. It is important that we deliver a bold and ambitious recovery plan for Scotland. My priority within government is to work collectively and collegiately to ensure that is the case. I recognise the important role that local authorities have to play in this respect, and I am leading engagement to strengthen our partnership with local government to support recovery and to maximise every possible benefit for our citizens.
Thank you. Co-Cabinet Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the Scottish Government will engage with the hospitality industry in particular and ensure support is put in place to recover from the effects of COVID and the loss of business?
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, we've obviously provided a tremendous amount of support to the hospitality sector to enable it to shoulder much of the strain that has come during the period of restrictions, and we are now operating in a context where the hospitality sector is able to trade in a fairly close to normal fashion, and we obviously welcome the contribution that the sector can make to the economy. Ministers have been involved in a range of different discussions with the hospitality sector involving a number of us. I myself have been involved in discussions principally with the Glasgow City Centre community, with whom Co-Cabinet will be very familiar from her own constituency interests and responsibilities, who are very much focused on supporting the recovery of the city centre to enable more footfall and, as a consequence, to boost the work of the hospitality sector. But the Government is happy to engage further with the sector on steps that we can positively take to address the concerns and aspirations of the hospitality community.
Thank you. Brief supplementary, Stephen Kerr.
Yes, thank you. What steps will the Scottish Government take to ensure that unrestricted COVID recovery funds spent by councils are spent on appropriate COVID recovery matters with well thought out plans that ensure the funds get to the people and the communities that need them and also deliver value for money for the UK taxpayer?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's an interesting philosophical point in the question that Mr Kerr raises, because there is a view, which I think has been pretty predominant within Parliament, that when we distribute funds to local authorities, it should be for local decision-making as to how that money is spent. For the government to come along and second-guess decisions made at a local level would, I think, possibly attract the, well, Mr Kerr is suggesting not second-guess. I'm not quite sure what would be happening if the government was scrutinising funding decisions taken by local authorities. Indeed, I think local authorities would frankly rail against such a stance by the government. Now, I'm happy to explore the points that Mr Kerr raises. If he's suggesting to me the government should be intervening in these matters, if that's the Conservative latest position, then I'll obviously explore that position. But fundamentally, I believe that a partnership with local government is a reliable and effective way to ensure that communities are well supported in the process.
Thank you. Question number four, Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to encourage people to engage with and respond to the COVID-19 recovery consultation.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, on the 17th of August, the Scottish Government launched a 12-week public consultation to review the legislative powers that have supported our response to COVID. This is a full public consultation open for views through to the 9th of November, which aims to support Scotland's recovery from COVID. The consultation has been widely publicised on social media, and a dedicated webpage has been established with supporting information. We have ensured that the 30 different topics which the consultation covers have been brought to the attention of key stakeholders. We are also considering how best to include the voice of disabled people in the consultation process following representations on that issue during the passage in Parliament of the Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Act 2021. I am pleased to say the consultation has already attracted a lot of interest and over 1,600 responses have been submitted so far.
Fulton MacGregor.
Yeah, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. During the pandemic, we've seen that swift progress was made to set up remote jury centres, and it's important that these services can continue to operate in a way that does not impede access to justice. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore outline what the Scottish Government's proposals are for helping our justice system renew and recover from the pandemic? And I should say as well that I'm just out of the Justice Committee session this morning with a really useful session with the Justice Minister. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the consultation invites views on 30 specific legislative proposals that have the potential to support COVID recovery, including proposals for justice system reform to ensure the tangible benefits of modernisations and practices adopted during the pandemic can be maintained where that is appropriate to do so. And I stress where that is appropriate to do so. Proposals will also cover the response to the impact of COVID in Scotland's justice system specifically, where backlogs have unavoidably built up. There is an opportunity in this consultation to address a number of the aspirations inherent to Mr MacGregor's question, and the Government looks forward to engaging with members of the public on those points.
Thank you. Question number 5, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its policies and actions across Government will support the North East to recover from COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, we are actively supporting economic recovery in the North East and have provided close to £100 million to support businesses and additional funding of almost £150 million to councils to help achieve that. We are also investing £157 million in the Aberdeen City Region and Moray Growth Deals and over £14 million to develop the skills needed to support regional economic recovery. Alongside this, we have recently confirmed our intention to commit £500 million capital to support the just transition of the region and Moray to support energy transition, create jobs and maximise the region's full economic potential.
Gillian Martin.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer and I welcome absolutely everything he has listed there. There's an opportunity in COVID recovery to address a number of government objectives and inequity in the ability to access fast, low emissions public transport. It's been one that's been long been an issue in my constituency and the wider eastern corner of North East Scotland. Will the Government and its commitment to reopen analysis of the Dyce to Ellen rail line look at the wider societal, environmental and economic benefits of such a rail link and base their decisions on wider criteria than simply projected passenger numbers? And will they commit to working with the people in my constituency and my neighbouring constituency on the case for the line, taking into account the workforce changes since COVID and the need for new jobs markets to be accessible to those seeking work in rural areas?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very happy to commit the Government to engage on that basis. The strategic developments to which Gillian Martin has referred are significant in the North East of Scotland. They provide the opportunity to contribute towards the achievement of the Government's aspirations and, well, I should say, obligations on net zero. And we look forward to engaging on those points, which will be the subject of further analysis as we develop these projects.
I have a couple of supplementaries. I'd welcome brief questions and succinct answers. First, Liam Kerr.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer. I met with Fraserburgh Harbour on Monday. Now, they detailed in their master plan some ambitious and exciting expansion plans which could significantly support the North East recovery from the pandemic and give even more reason to send the train up there as well as road improvements. Does the Scottish Government support Fraserburgh Harbour's ambitions and will the Cabinet Secretary back their expansion proposals?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Government obviously engages on a range of projects around the country. Resources are challenging, I think everybody knows that, but I certainly welcome the proposals to which the Member refers and my ministerial colleagues will be happy to engage on any proposals that come forward.
And Michael Mara.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Re-immobilising our NHS will be critical to our COVID recovery in the North East, and ensuring we have the staff in place to do that is absolutely vital. Will the Deputy First Minister help that process by supporting the district nurses in Dundee who, 3 years ago, were regraded from a band 6 to a band 7 but have not had that process honoured by NHS Tayside? Does the Deputy First Minister agree that's a disgraceful situation after these nurses' selfless service in the pandemic? And will his government intervene to ensure that upgrading is honoured immediately?
Cabinet Secretary.
As Mr Mara will be aware, this is an issue that will be the responsibility of NHS Tayside to determine. Obviously, the board must make its decisions appropriate with all of the advice that's available to it, and I'll certainly draw his representations to the attention of NHS Tayside as a consequence of our exchange today.
Thank you. Question 6, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will commit to ensuring that any legislation it introduces to support the recovery from COVID-19 pandemic does not seek to allow regulations to be made or changed without being subject to the affirmative parliamentary procedures.
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank Alexander Stewart for asking my first ministerial question and answering it. I would say the government is currently consulting in 30 specific public health, public services and justice system proposals that have potential to support COVID recovery. Given the range of topics and potential scenarios which the consultation covers, the government cannot commit to the standard affirmative procedure applying in all circumstances in any bills or bills which we bring forward following the consultation. However, I can commit to ensuring that we consider carefully how we ensure that the Scottish Parliament has the ability to effectively scrutinise any regulations which the government brings forward under future regulations. Of course, any bills or bills which the government brings forward will be subject to parliamentary scrutiny, and there will be the opportunity for the Delegated Powers and Law Reforms Committee and other committees in the Chamber to fully consider the procedures which apply to delegated powers.
Thank you, Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Minister for that response. Under current coronavirus legislation, regulations do not have to be proactively put before the Scottish Parliament if Scottish ministers consider that the regulations need to be made urgently. Does the Minister agree that enacting regulations without a prior vote or improving regulations with affect everyone's lives is unacceptable? And will he rule out the inclusion of such clauses in any legislation that which enshrines the temporary coronavirus powers?
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In answering, I would say, as the situation with the pandemic has changed, swift action in terms of legal restrictions requirements have been required to be taken by ministers, and the emergency coronavirus regulations have been required to take effect quickly. This is the case not only when restrictions requirements have required to be imposed quickly, but also when restrictions requirements have been lifted because they are no longer necessary. The affirmative procedure allows the swift response to be put restrictions in place and also to lift them as soon as they are no longer necessary. And to answer the question, there is a time and a place for us to be able to do things to make things better for people in Scotland.
Thank you. Question number 7, Annabel Yu.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will outline the timescale for the independent public inquiry into the handling of the COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Scottish Government will establish a Scottish public inquiry under the Inquiries Act 2005 by the end of this year to scrutinise decisions taken in the course of this pandemic and learn lessons for future pandemics. The Scottish Government is currently inviting views on the draft aims and principles of this inquiry, which will shape the terms of reference. Discussions are also ongoing with the United Kingdom Government on the planned UK inquiry to ensure all areas that need to be considered are covered in a way that gives confidence to bereaved families and others.
Annabel Yu.
I thank the Deputy First Minister for his answer, and given the significant importance of the issues involved, I wonder if it is anticipated that there could perhaps be staggered reporting made as the inquiry in fact progresses, for example, by way of interim reports, such that important lessons can be learned and recommendations can be made in a timely manner. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Annabel Yu makes an absolutely reasonable point, but the process and the timescale of the inquiry will be matters for the chair of the inquiry operating independently of ministers, but we can of course set out some of our expectations as a consequence of our discussions with interested parties. There has been of course a very good example of the way in which phased reporting can illuminate some of the issues being wrestled with in an inquiry in the inquiry chaired by Lady Smith into historic abuse, where a number of case studies have reported providing clarity and certainty for many individuals who have suffered in that process. So there are models that can operate in the spirit of the points raised by Annabel Ewing, and I will consider those issues as we establish the terms of reference.
Thank you. And question 8, Siobhan Brown, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask what assurances the Scottish Government has had from the UK Government on that decisions on spending on the recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic will be taken in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the UK Government's Internal Market Act has undermined any assurance around decisions on COVID recovery spending in devolved areas being taken in Scotland. The Act's spending powers cover a wide range of areas, including some related to COVID recovery. Any such spending could bring the prospect of uncoordinated spending and policy incoherence that could actually hinder rather than support COVID recovery. The way that the UK Government has used these powers so far offers little assurance, rather the opposite.
Siobhan Brown.
Thank you for that answer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that it is absolutely crucial that no more devolved powers should be stripped from the Scottish Parliament, and decisions on spending on COVID recovery in Scotland should be firmly placed in the hands of the Scottish Parliament?
And Cabinet Secretary.
I agree with that point. I think the Scottish Government has made it absolutely crystal clear, indeed this Parliament has made it crystal clear, that the UK Government's Internal Market Act is an unwelcome piece of legislation which undermines the powers of the Scottish Parliament. It is crucial that the powers of the Scottish Parliament are respected, the powers that were supported by people in a referendum in 1997 and subsequently enhanced by the various legislative instruments that have been passed. Our decision-making structure should not be undermined or eroded by the United Kingdom Government.
Thank you very much, and that concludes portfolio questions on COVID-19. We now move to portfolio questions, net zero, energy and transport. Again, if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, I'd ask them to press the request to speak button or put an R in the chat function if they're joining us virtually during the course of that relevant question. I'm conscious that already there are a number of members who've indicated they want supplementary questions. We're also, I think, breaking new ground with four different ministers answering questions in this session. So I'd be grateful for brief questions and brief answers wherever possible. And let me start with question number one, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it expects to implement the provisions on pavement parking prohibition in the Transport Scotland Act 2019.
Minister Graham Day.
Deputy Presiding Officer, officials are continuing to consult with the local authorities to develop both the secondary legislation and parking standards guidance, and with the public on areas contained within the legislation. In addition, local authorities require around 12 months to undertake assessments to consider whether they wish to exempt, subject to criteria, any areas of pavement from the prohibition. As such, the majority of the secondary legislation is likely to be in place by 2022.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Minister for his answer. It's now almost been 2 years since the legislation received royal assent. What funding is the Government providing to aid the implementation of the provisions to ban pavement parking, and what assessment has it done of any funding it has provided on this to date?
Minister.
President Officer, as the Member is aware, implementation of the parking elements of that were hindered both by COVID and Brexit, but the work is now well underway. The specific point about funding, sitting alongside the draft chapters of the Parking Standards Guidance document, which has gone to councils, an initial £1.6 million of funding for these assessments has been distributed.
Thank you. Question number two, Colin Beattie, who again is joining us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government what further guidance and support it will provide community groups to help them meet the goal of net zero emissions.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Deputy Presiding Officer, we must engage communities right across the country in our journey to net zero. Communities are being supported via the Climate Challenge Fund, as well as through the developing network of climate action hubs and towns. We are also launching a number of national initiatives in the run-up to Climate Week. Our new website, netzeronation.scot, aims to help the public and communities understand how they can play their part in tackling the global climate emergency and provide resources for community action. The website also signposts to further practical and financial support available to communities through other initiatives.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. In my constituency of Midlothian, North and Musselburgh, there are well over 250 community groups of varying sizes and levels of activity. What financial support might be made available to these groups to assist them on their journey to net zero?
Cabinet Secretary.
There are a number of different Scottish Government funding packages available to communities. So, for example, I know one project in the member's own constituency in Pennycook, the Pennycook Community Development Trust, they were awarded just under £116,000 this financial year from the Climate Challenge Fund for their Pennycook Carbon Challenge project, which offers free support to help residents and groups to reduce their carbon footprint by tackling waste. Funding that's currently available to support communities in their journey to net zero also includes the Scottish Government Community and Renewable Energy Scheme, which provides advice, loans and grant funding with up to £5.25 million available this financial year to support local community groups to develop renewable energy projects, supporting the growth of community and locally owned energy projects. There's also the Energy Saving Trust programme, which delivers a range of initiatives through the e-bike grant scheme and also provides support to community-based organisations to move to active travel. There's also further community support through the local Love Local campaign, which has been rolled out at a national level. So there are a range of different funding streams that community groups can have access to, and I would certainly want to encourage any community group who is looking for advice on the funding streams to look to the Net Zero Nation website for further information, or to the Scottish Communities Climate Action Network website, which also has a considerable amount of information in this area.
Thank you. Question number three, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Net Zero Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding action to support small and medium-sized businesses to reduce their carbon emissions as part of a wider effort to reach net zero targets.
Cabinet Secretary.
I meet regularly with ministerial colleagues to discuss the collective action being taken across the Scottish Government to support our net zero ambitions. In advance of COP26, we have made targeted commitments to drive opportunities for Scottish businesses and supply chains. For example, an additional £2 billion of infrastructure investment over the current Parliament to help to stimulate demand and create jobs in the transition to net zero. As part of our Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, we will also build a toolkit to help small and micro businesses to develop the skills and knowledge they need to adapt to the demands of the transition to net zero. And we're also working across the Scottish Government to finalise plans for the Scottish Climate Week, which will run from the 13th to the 19th of September, which will support SMEs across Scotland to hold events or to take forward climate action with their own teams.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? He may be aware of research by accountancy firm Grant Thornton, which suggests that roughly only half of businesses have a net zero strategy, despite strong recognition from the business community of the value of strong environmental performance. With such a high proportion of Scottish business in the SME sector, will the Scottish Government put a higher priority on supporting that kind of innovation in the SMEs towards net zero, rather than constantly targeting the few big businesses that currently Scotland have?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, officer, everyone has a collective responsibility to play their part in helping to achieve Scotland becoming a net zero nation by 2045, whether it be an individual, community or at a business level, whether that be an SME or whether it be a major corporation. They all have a part to play in helping to support us in achieving that target. There's a range of action we're already taking. So, for example, I mentioned the Net Zero Nation campaign, which has presently been rolled out in order to inform individuals, communities and businesses on the actions and the opportunities that they can take forward in achieving net zero are all part of the ongoing plan. But it's equally important that we also help to support businesses to seize the opportunities which will arise as we go forward in becoming a net zero nation through the new technology which will have to be developed, the deployment of that new technology across both domestic and non-domestic premises. all of which provide opportunities for SMEs across the country to play their part in the range of work we're taking forward on the Skills Academy and in other areas around green skills are all about helping to support SMEs across the country to be able to do exactly that.
Thank you. And a brief supplementary, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. According to research by Citizen Advice Scotland published earlier this year, Scottish businesses were less likely than businesses across the UK to have introduced decarbonisation measures. Will the Government adopt all the recommendations in that report, and can the Cabinet Secretary say how much funding is available for the toolkit he mentioned?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, Officer, the question which has just been asked by Monica Lennon relates back to the answer I just gave to Mr Whittle, and that is it's important that all parts of our community, including businesses, play their part in helping us to meet that net zero nation. That's why the ongoing communication plan, engagement with business organisations in helping to support them and helping to inform their members about the work that they can take forward in order to become net zero businesses. And the reality is, from the engagement I've had with businesses, both at an SME level and at a corporate level, is that they also recognise that actually becoming net zero becomes a key part of their business, and that they recognise that people want to see businesses playing their part in achieving this. And that's why we've got funding streams through a number of programmes that can support businesses to get loans and grants to assist them in decarbonising their operations. And a big part of that will be about making sure we build on that as we progress and going forward. I don't have a specific figure on the toolkit, but the toolkit is an important part of what the business community have asked us for, to help to support those businesses that don't have plans just now, to put plans in place to assist them in doing that and to make sure that they're taking the necessary action that's required.
Thank you. Question number four, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government how much it has spent and plans to spend over the next 4 years on the mitigation of landslips at the Rest and Be Thankful on the A83.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, we've invested £87 million in the maintenance of the A83 since 2007, including over £15 million in landslide mitigation works to provide additional resilience at the Rest and Be Thankful, including debris netting, bunds and improvements to drainage. Subject to the annual budget process and spending review, our current plan is to spend a further £8.8 million over the coming years on short-term mitigation measures. There is also budget set aside for progression of the medium and long-term works within Glencroe, which shows it's our absolute determination to invest in this road in the short, medium and long term to help keep our Argyll open for business and enable residents and visitors alike to travel to and from the area.
Jackie Bailey.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? Given that he acknowledged £50 million has been spent, a further £8 million is in the pipeline, and £1 million has recently been spent on extending the catch pits at the Rest and Be Thankful, does the Minister think that this will be enough to withstand a large landslide of, say, 100 tonnes of debris? And if so, why does Transport Scotland keep closing the road when it rains? Does he believe, therefore, that now is the time for all alternatives to be explored to maintain access to Argyll?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as Jackie Bailey well knows, because we've met on this issue, there are no certainties about this. We are in the hands of Mother Nature. And I know she would not be sitting there suggesting to me that we shouldn't conduct these measures. We need to do it to minimise the risk here. There is a great deal of effort goes in to ensuring that any risk associated with this route is minimised. But I absolutely agree with her, and I hope I can give her some assurance if she doesn't have it already. This is a parallel process that is taking place. Every mitigation possible is being deployed, but at exactly the same time, work has gone on in developing proposals for the medium and long term to provide the outcome that we all desire.
And re-supplementary, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Scottish Government give assurance to the residents, businesses and visitors of Argyll and Bute that the mitigation work currently underway is not at the detriment of the long-term solution? And could the Minister share with Parliament the timeline to find that solution?
Minister.
Well, as I've just said to Jackie Bailey, this is a parallel process. The current mitigation work, the medium-term development work and the long-term work. We're in the phase at the moment of data gathering to inform the best choice of specific route. That should be concluded by the end of this year. All being well, at that point, we'll have a clearer picture on the workable options. We would then move to the development of a final proposal for that medium-term solution. There are, of course, many unknowns here. Ownership of the land, depending on the route, engineering requirements, ground conditions. But we're working with all haste on this. I don't want to give hostages to fortune, but I think it is feasible that we would be, towards the end of next year, have a firm proposal to take forward, a shovel-ready proposal. I think that's where we would certainly hope to be at that point.
Thank you. Question number 5, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw members' attention to my register of interest as an owner of a rented property in North Lanarkshire. To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it has commissioned of the likely costs to homeowners and landlords of reaching net zero emissions in housing by 2045.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Scottish Government analysis suggests that the total capital cost of converting our building stock to zero emissions by 2045 is in the region of £33 billion. This includes installation of zero emissions heat and of energy efficiency measures in both domestic and non-domestic buildings. And it doesn't take account of the business as usual investments that households and businesses would need to make to replace fossil fuel boilers as they reach the end of their lives, nor the additional investment likely to be needed in wider energy infrastructure. The government has commissioned a range of further research to understand the wider costs associated with the heat transition, which will be published once it's finalised.
Thank you. Mark Griffin.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Recent announcements about decarbonisation of all properties across all tenures across the wider Glasgow city region area put them at a cost of £9 billion to decarbonise their heating and make them energy efficient. Two-thirds of those 300,000 are owner-occupied properties, and some will be able to afford a contribution, but we know many, including my constituencies, won't. Can the Minister set out the Government plans on how to support low-income owner-occupiers with little savings, and what the expectations on those owner-occupiers will be, and what support will be provided by the Government to enable them to participate fully in that travel towards 2045?
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank the Member for the question. I don't think anyone doubts that this is a mammoth challenge for us all, and it will have a wide range of impacts on people in different tenures and different economic circumstances. The Scottish Government already makes available support, for example, through the Home Energy Scotland loan scheme, interest-free unsecured loans of up to £38,500 per home to owner-occupiers to install energy efficiency and heat measures. There's a cashback scheme providing eligible households of up to £13,500 towards zero-emission heating systems and energy efficiency measures. There's a range of other schemes, including area-based schemes, which have been extended to include zero-emissions heating, and the Scottish Government has introduced a top-up grant to support this. But as we go forward, I think that the Member will be well aware that we'll continue to research the scale of the challenge and the steps that need to be taken, both by this Government and by the UK Government, whose actions will be necessary to make zero-carbon heating systems affordable by comparison with fossil fuel systems.
Thank you. And a very brief supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary recently told me it would cost £17,000 per property to upgrade off-gas grid homes from EPC band E to G to EPC C. There are around 500,000 off-grid homes, and over 100,000 of those can't be fitted with a heat pump. So it will cost, even if it was just those upgraded,
this isn't
over
brief,
£1
billion.
What analysis is being done on this, and who will be expected to pay?
Minister Patrick Harvey, briefly.
Well, I've already indicated a significant range of measures by which the public purse helps to meet these costs. Obviously, the public purse can't meet all of it, and nor should homeowners meet all of it. It's a challenge that we all have to rise to. In relation to heat pumps, I think most of us would recognise there's not one single solution that's right for every property in every location. And so we don't intend to take a mandatory approach to imposing a single solution for all properties. But as with Mr Griffin, I'm sure that the Government will want to keep Mr Kerr and all parties informed of further work in this area.
Thank you. Question number 6, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reported proposals by ScotRail to no longer run 300 train services from May 2022.
Minister Graham Day.
President Officer, let me begin by providing a full picture of the ScotRail proposal. I'm sure that Colin Smith is not deliberately trying to give the impression that service levels overall are being reduced. The fact is that under these proposals, we would see an increase of 100 services per day on the current level. By way of example, Glasgow to Carlisle, Kilmarnock and Dumfries in the Members' region would benefit. The review seeks to create a national rail service that meets the country's needs and travel patterns. ScotRail has examined pre-COVID and expected future demand and developed a proposed timetable that seeks to match service patterns with uptake, with scope for additional future capacity, whilst recognising the need for financial and environmental sustainability. The proposed timetable is a new starting point, not the end point. It has been designed to accommodate pre-pandemic levels of demand, whilst removing much of the unused capacity on the network. As more people return to using rail, further services that there are demand for will be introduced. The public consultation provides an opportunity for ScotRail customers and businesses to help shape a reliable and responsive timetable change, and I would encourage the people to make their views known.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. I'm sure the Minister doesn't want to mislead people in implying that the overall number of services are not going to be reduced compared to pre-pandemic level, because that's exactly what the proposals are. And we won't get people back on our trains, frankly, Minister, by taking that train away. So can I ask the Minister very specifically, will the SNP Green Government rule out reducing the overall number of rail services compared to pre-pandemic levels when that new timetable is introduced in May 2022?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, it's frankly baffling that a Member of Parliament can sit here and call for a never-ending increase in services with no consideration for the cost, frankly. There has been a direction of travel set by this government pre-pandemic that saw services increase, stations open up, and that is the journey that we are on. We are currently in a...
Listen to the response, please.
Now, President Officer, I've yet as a parliamentarian to encounter any set of draft proposals which are perfect or indeed are not ultimately amended in some form as the associated processes are worked through. So it's important that people work in the consultation. But in doing this, we have to be realistic. We cannot run services which are little utilised. As we build back, we need to match services to demand and build from there. And alongside all of this, we'll be delivering a raft of improvements, such as decarbonisation of the network, new stations, and a modal shift from freight, for freight from road to rail.
Who's supplementary, James Dornan?
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I wonder if the Minister could tell us what's changed in rail services in Scotland since the SNP came to power in 2007.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, a very great deal, and for the better, is the answer. Under this government, communities and businesses have benefited from significant investment across Scotland's railways. We've seen that in terms of the number of seats on trains. We've seen it in the stations that have reopened. We've seen it in decarbonisation. And that, as I said earlier, is the direction of travel. To characterise this, since 2008, prior to the pandemic, there were 190,000 more seats on our trains compared to 2008.
Thank you. And a very, very brief supplementary, Graham Simpson.
I'm very grateful. Minister, is this a taste of things to come when ScotRail is nationalised?
Minister.
That's exactly the kind of question I would have expected from Mr Simpson. The direction of travel that's been set by this government is very clear. Investment in rail, decarbonisation of rail, and a great deal of support for rail. That is where we are going.
Thank you very much. Question number 7, Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure that water scarcity reporting is accurate and reflective of all areas of Scotland.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, SEPA is responsible for the forecast, monitoring and reporting of the situation facing Scotland's water resources and produces a weekly report on this. Of course, on the ground, information from local authorities is absolutely crucial in understanding the impact that drought is having on water supplies. And that's why a dedicated reporting line has been set up, enabling local authorities to provide real-time information to the Scottish Government and to SEPA. And the Scottish Government very much values the monitoring and assessment work that goes on in that regard.
Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the Minister for that answer. It was alarming to have constituents contact me during the summer to advise that the private water supplies were lower dry. and that we were a standing start of supplying emergency drinking water. I would like to note my thanks for the assistance from the Scottish Government to my many constituents who aren't on mains water supply due to the rurality of their properties. And I ask that the Minister commits to ensuring the robustness of water scarcity reporting so that both spheres of government can react to the very real humanitarian crisis when indicators suggest that private water supplies are at risk.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I understand the Member's concerns, and as someone who personally relies on a private water supply, I understand the concerns of those who have experienced scarcity. In recognition of those scarcity events this summer, the Scottish Government acted quickly to fund a scheme for the provision of supplies of bottled water. And that scheme is on top of an existing non-means-tested grant of £800, which is already available to owners and users of private water supplies to make improvements to their system. The National Water Scarcity Plan sets out clearly how water scarcity levels are determined by SEPA and how these are informed using a scientific approach and current research.
Thank you. And question 8, Polly McNeill.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what support it plans to provide Glasgow City Council to implement the recommendations in the report by the Connectivity Commission, including funding for the proposed metro system.
Mr Graham Day.
Thank you, Officer. Paul McNeill will of course be aware that this work was commissioned by Glasgow City Council and it will be for the Council to determine if it wishes to implement the Commission's recommendations. However, we are progressing the second Strategic Transport Projects Review, which is considering the case for a Glasgow Metro, and the Scottish Government is working collaboratively with Glasgow City Council on this. Decisions on future funding will be made after STPR2 is concluded and as part of the Scottish Budget process. Of course, the Glasgow City Region local authorities have over £1 billion in their Growth Deal Infrastructure Fund, of which the Scottish Government committed £500 million to use for investment in infrastructure like the Glasgow Metro.
Polly McNeill.
So the Minister will be aware that it's one of the biggest projects that Glasgow intends to support to transition to sustainable transport, so it's a really important project. However, from press reports, the private finance which the Leader of the Council is seeking does look uncertain. So I wonder if the Minister would share some of my concerns that this needs to be nailed down and that Glasgow City's intention to at least partly fund the metro system with private finance does raise some questions on whether the necessary progress is going to be made in a reasonable timescale. So I totally accept there's a collaboration, but I just hope the Scottish Government can assure me that they will take a strong interest in Glasgow being Scotland's largest city, because we desperately need a project that will help us transition to net zero, and this looks like it could be the one.
Minister Graham Day.
Briefly, Presiding Officer, the fact that this project features an STPR2 is a recognition of its national importance.
Thank you very much indeed. That brings to an end portfolio questions. It'll be a short break before we move to the next item of business.